If you preached Father's Day, anybody did? I did last weekend. My church has told me don't tell any more Father's Day jokes. And when I tell these dad jokes, they give me a thumbs up or a thumbs down. I personally believe I have the worst dad jokes. That is, but you say you don't.
I'm confident my dad jokes are worse than yours.
I don't think so. All right, so I've told my church, okay, thumbs up if it's a bad joke, all right? So the tallest building in the world, you know what it is?
I have no idea.
It's the library because it has hundreds of stories. Yes.
Did you know that Elon Musk is actually going to be opening up a new restaurant on the moon?
I did not.
Food is going to be incredible, but there will be no atmosphere.
Which one was the worst? Yeah. Okay, you win. You win. You win. We just wanted to add a little levity here, and before we get started, I want to ask you to watch this video.
Then I saw in the right hand of him who was seated on the throne a scroll written within and on the back, sealed with seven seals.
Het deed me veel verdriet dat blijkbaar niemand het verdiende om de boekrol te openen en hem in te zien.
Et l'un des vieillards me dit:
Ken asapotus presbyteros moulai, min klas, na, υπερίσχυσε το λεοντάρι, που είναι από τη φυλή του Ιούδα, η ρίζα του Δαβίδ, να ανοίξει το βιβλίο και να λύσει τις επτά σφραγίδες του.
அப்பொழுது ஏதோ அதிகப்பட்ட வனமாய் இருக்கிற ஒரு ஆட்டுக்குட்டி சிங்காசனத்திற்கும் நான்கு ஜீவன்களுக்கும் மூப்புறங்களுக்கும் மத்தியில் இருக்க
கண்டேன். Enviados por toda a terra.
Na baba je ang umano wo niya watse ang wano dino ninyimfa.
At nang makuha niya ang balungbon, nagpatira pa sa harap ng kordero ang apat na buhay na nilalang at ang 24 na matatanda.
Amen kanal kanarner unain u voski kangamarner hungov letsun vor surperun agokner nene.
And they sang a new song saying,
주님께서는 그 두루마리를 받으시고 임봉을 떼실 자격이 있으십니다. 왜냐하면 주님의 피로 사람들을 사서 하나님께 드렸기 때문입니다.
De toute tribu,
à pour quatre filles,
sacre compte de Rome,
and language,
the orte lingua,
baixa valinde,
baiana,
e povo,
e fchorro volte,
e nação,
e flamena,
e nhamani nemo,
from every tribe and language and people and nation.
Galtana le ilahana mulukan wa kahanatan, sanamluk al ard.
A viděl jsem a slyšel hlas mnoha andělů okolo toho trůnu, těch bytostí a těch starců. Byli jich miliony a miliardy a volali mocným hlasem.
Vredníke jste mi a lulkada foste žungia, sa primiaska puterea, bogacia, înțelepciunea, tăria, cinstea, slava și lauda.
I svako sfornia, što je na nebu, i na zemi, i pod zemljom, i što je na moru, i što je u njim, sve čuj gde govore.
I mi ola ugu, a ti agbarani, ti eni tio džo kolori te, a ti odo agoto, lai a ti lai lai.
And the four living creatures said,
Amin.
Amin.
Amen.
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 And the elders fell down and worshiped.
Dean, would you introduce our team?
I would love to do that. My brother, why don't we start all the way over on the left side. Phyllis, would you please stand up? And if you would just tell people your name, your church, and your presbytery, please.
Phyllis LePoe, Emmanuel Presbyterian Church, and Rivers and Lakes. Rivers and Lakes.
Andrew Smith, Kenneth Square Presbyterian Church, just outside Philadelphia in the Presbytery of the East.
Brandon Queen, First Pres, Thibodaux, Louisiana, Gulf South Presbytery.
Tim Russell, Second Presbyterian Church, Memphis, Central South.
Good morning, I'm Beth Paz, Fresno, First Presbyterian Church, Presbytery of the Pacific Southwest.
Mark DeJay, planting pastor of Soma in Beaver Falls, Pennsylvania, Presbytery of the Alleghenies.
Tom Werner, ruling elder, Green Tree Community Church, and former moderator.
And speaking of former moderators, I'm Dean Weaver, the lead pastor at Memorial Park Church in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, the Presbytery of the Alleghenies. And you are?
Rufus Smith, teaching elder at Hope Presbyterian Church in Memphis, Tennessee. We have three others who are not here today, but this makes up our team. And they wouldn't say it, of course, but Beth just finished her Master's of Divinity just a few days ago, and Mark DeJay just finished his doctorate, a few days ago. So Dr. Mark, we appreciate this team being here. Amen. So what is Revelation 7:9? In a nutshell, as America becomes more ethnically and age diverse, and the next generation becomes more gospel adverse, Revelation 7:9 essentially is saying that we need to execute the Great Commission, Matthew 28, Acts 1:8, and others. We need to execute the Great Commission in a more effective way to reach our wider world. It's as simple as that, and it's as hard as that. Let me repeat. As America becomes more ethnically and age diverse, but the next generation becomes and is more gospel adverse, the task of Revelation 7:9, us in the EPC, is to figure out how can we improve our execution of the Great Commission. It's as simple as that, and it is as hard as that. So Matthew 28:19, we're all familiar with. It is interesting that Jesus said to these very Jewish followers, as you are going, make disciples of every nation. The word is ethnos. Make disciples of every ethnicity. And these very Jewish followers had to go into their Gentile world among ethnics they were not familiar with, and with a whole nother generation be what the church had become. And that's our task here with Revelation 7:9. It's as simple as that and as hard as that.
Well, if you go beyond that, Rufus, to Acts chapter 1 and verses 6 through 8, we see that the strategy that's unfolded in the book of Acts is that it starts in Jerusalem, and then it goes to Judea, Samaria, and then to the uttermost parts of the earth. The interesting thing is we tend to think of going to the ethne, the people groups of the world, as at the other end of the world. But much like the time of the second chapter of Acts, the Lord is bringing the world to our neighborhoods. And for many of us, in a 1 to 3 and 5 mile radius, we will find people that aren't typically populating Presbyterian churches. We'll find people that we have oftentimes overlooked. They could be people from different socioeconomic backgrounds. They could be people from different age groups than what our congregation represents. People with disabilities that we just don't see in our blind spots, or people of different ethnicities. We believe God has a richer picture in store in Revelation 7:9. I looked and therefore beheld, before me was a multitude too great to count, from every tribe, every nation, every people, and every language.
Wonderful. And as we have listened this first year as a task force to you as individuals through a survey through presbyteries, we are gathering information. And our former moderator, Tom Werner, will come and just recapitulate the survey.
Many of you have received a copy of this report, and basically the information I'm going to give you is in the report, page 2 and 3. So we started off our listening by doing a survey of pastors of churches, and we received responses from 193 churches about questions of race and ethnicity. And so I want to give you some of the information that's on the top of the third page. So there's good news and there's things to work on. We found that over 90% of the leadership staff of responding churches is majority culture. We found that of responding churches, about just over half have a significant ethnic population within a 1, 3, or 5 mile radius. The next question we asked was, if you have such a population within your ministry reach, do you have a strategy to reach that group? I don't know what you think the percentage would be, but we were satisfied, we were pleased to find that 50% had such a strategy. We thought that was pretty good. The next question is, if you have a minority population and a strategy, do you believe that your strategy is effective? And again, I think the numbers were pretty good there. We had half of the people who thought that their strategies were effective. Now, the next numbers aren't so good. Of the responding churches, people were asked to rate whether they were presenting the gospel to minority culture neighbors effectively. 4% said that they were presenting the gospel very effectively. Perhaps that's our Puerto Rican friends who make that 4% up. 22% of churches said they present the gospel fairly effectively. 37% said that they are poor, mediocre, and 37% said that they are not very effective. We next asked about passion within the church to present the gospel to minority culture neighbors. Among pastoral staff, 81% said that there is passion among pastoral and leadership staff to present the gospel to minority culture neighbors, but we were somewhat saddened to see that that level of passion decreases as you move from pastors to elders and to congregations. It's not surprising, but it means that we have work to do as pastors and elders in our congregation. There you have it.
Bless you. There were several questions that were asked. We're going to just give a synopsis of some. One of the questions was if Revelation 7:9, the verse itself, is more descriptive than prescriptive, and I've asked Andrew to address that.
Could I just jump in here real quick?
Sorry to interrupt this report, but we need to excuse our women for the ministry wives luncheon that is going to be taking place down at Greenwood. Please, you're excused now. The buses will be departing in a few minutes. Thank you very much.
Now, with that interruption, we get an extra 30 seconds on our report. Okay, just double checking.
So as Rufus said, one of the questions we've been asked is Revelation 7:9 in our understanding more prescriptive or descriptive? And that's an excellent question. And to shoot to the chase, we would say, of course, Revelation 7:9 is descriptive. It's descriptive of the fulfillment of God's redemptive purpose that begins all the way back in the Garden of Eden. A couple of days ago in one of the Leadership Institute seminars, Dr. Scott read from RTS DC, pointed out that in the Garden of Eden, that is not God's ultimate goal for us. He's not trying to get us back to Eden. God's purpose, his intention for us is not Eden restored. It is a new heaven and a new earth. And Revelation 7:9 tells us about that new heaven and an earth, tells us about the reality there, of every nation, tribe, and tongue being present. So Revelation 7:9 is descriptive. It's descriptive of God's ultimate purpose of fulfilling his promise to Abraham of descendants who are as numerous as the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore. But Revelation 7:9 is also prescriptive. In the middle of the Lord's Prayer, in Matthew 6, we have this phrase, on earth as it is in heaven. Jonathan Pennington, in his recent book, The Sermon on the Mount and Human Flourishing, points out that that phrase is not just attached to the third petition, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. It's actually the bridge between the entire first half of the prayer and the entire second half of the prayer. So that, amongst other things, we're praying that God's name would be hallowed on earth as it is in heaven, that the kingdom would come on earth as it is in heaven. And what does that kingdom look like? John tells us it's a kingdom of every nation, tribe, and tongue. And that's why Jesus leans into the Great Commission and says, I want you to go and tell the nations, the ethne, the good news of the gospel, so that you, as you go in your evangelism and your discipleship as churches, you become part of the way God is fulfilling his promise to us as we pray that part of the Lord's Prayer. So is Revelation 7:9 prescriptive or descriptive? We don't think it's an either or. We think it's a both and.
All right. Thank you, Andrew. And thank you for representing the ta ethne from Ireland. We appreciate that very much. As Rufus mentioned, we've had a whole number of questions as we've gone to presbyteries and done our listening. One of the questions that we've had is some have asked, how do we learn to worship interethnically or intergenerationally without giving up the reformed distinctives of worship? And I was going to ask if Tim and Brandon might step forward and speak to that, if they would, please.
What are we giving up? My answer is nothing. As one trained in whose personal preferences are classical music, particularly Handel and Bach, contemporary music, gospel, that out of the great African-American tradition, and the Psalms and scriptures sung a cappella, I have a great range of things that I might like. But all of those things are prescribed in the scripture, as we understand it, by the regulative principle of worship, the Westminster Confession of Faith, and each session is equipped and has the discernment to make the decisions about what are the needs for that congregation and its needs, their locality, and we trust that each session will make those decisions well. At Second Presbyterian, I've described to you some of what our worship is like. We don't feel like we've given up anything at all. What we've gained is a diverse membership, visiting population, and inquirers into the gospel who are attracted in great measure, not only because of the preaching, but also because of the joyful worship. That's how we do it there. The question, do we lose anything? No, we've gained in biblical worship and people who have come to know Jesus as a result of that.
In the new generation, we have this term to be woke, but I'm not going to use it here. In the words of Rufus Smith, in my humble yet honest opinion, sometimes we can see ethnicity and generation as a hindrance to our purpose and our calling. Moreover, no one has ever been called to walk alone in his or her own faith. We walk together. So then, our reformed distinctiveness should unite us together as one in Christ, as one under his headship. It is then that we can worship God together without any ethnic or generational barriers that could possibly divide us. We must remember that the Reformed faith is a Reformed faith given to us by Christ. A good friend of mine who is actually in the audience today told me this, that the gospel, that gospel-centered worship that is Christ-exalting biblically and committed to the Reformed faith feels like home, or better yet, should matter if our music choices or the way we exuberate our worship shouldn't matter. But it brings me to our denominational's motto. In essentials, unity. In non-essentials, liberty. In all things, charity. So let's just do worship together. Thank you.
Beth, we've been grappling with this question basically that says, is an ethnically diverse, age diverse, and economically diverse the only way forward as far as Revelation 7:9 interpretation is concerned?
Thank you, Pastor. I think there's a couple of ways to faithfully live into the heartbeat of Revelation 7. One would be a multi-ethnic congregation that's flourishing as a witnessing community. The second is an ethnically aware, reconciling community. Both of them get to experience the beauty of mutual transformation that comes with proximity. Both of them are contextually relevant. They get to look and see and do the faithful work of crossing the barriers that are presented within their context, barriers of age, of race, of class. So within this work, though, I feel like one thing that saddens me would be a monoethnic church whose only interactions with people on the margins would be through charity work or supporting foreign mission. That troubles me. It also troubles me to have a multi-ethnic gathering paying lip service to the work of diversity without doing the hard work of power sharing and racial reconciliation. So, in sum, my answer would be, I think the best expression of a church pushing into the heartbeat of Revelation 7 is multi-ethnic, but all are called to the faithful work of crossing barriers for the sake of the ministry of reconciliation.
Last question.
All right, so the last question, Mark, is for you. As we've gone around to different presbyteries and listened in, I think some are concerned that perhaps this is coming out of either a political correctness or perhaps a desire to acquiesce to a more social gospel or a liberation theology. So could you speak to that as a newly doctorized pastor?
Yes, so you think I know what I'm talking about. That's good. Hilariously, there's 1 minute, 30 seconds total for the rest of our time. So that's so dense. I will just say this, let's not let our fear of the slippery slope lead us into heretical dualistic thinking, that we would say it's either or, right? That it's either the soul or the body. It's either the here and now or the ever after. It's either the personal or the social, that God is in fact the God of all of it, and the clear reading of Scripture, I believe, faithfully, and particularly the life of Jesus shows us that God is the Lord of everything, sovereign over everything. And so very, very quickly, just the story of Jesus being asked the question, what is the greatest commandment? And Jesus' response was, to love God, to love God. He was asked one question, but he gave two answers, didn't he? He said, and the second is like it, to love your neighbor as yourself. There's no dualistic thinking when it comes to the way that God is making his kingdom known. He is God and Lord of all of it. So we don't need to look into a 19th, 20th century theological movement. We look into the heart of God in Scripture revealed in Jesus Christ. And as long as we're doing that and staying faithful to that, God's whole counsel in Scripture and the life and ministry of Jesus, I think we're going to be in good shape.
All right. My brother Rufus, would you bring us to a close here?
Absolutely. I've been in APC almost 21 years, and I must say that it looks a little different than it was 21 years ago, and for that I'm grateful, and I'm totally excited about the missional aspect, the church planning aspect, and what could come out of Revelation 7:9 as to what we can look like in the future. So our question is, before us, is an ethnically, age, and economically diverse church, and our local churches in the EPC, is it a luxury? Is it a practical necessity or a spiritual priority? And I want us to know that I am as proud as I can be of our direction. Dean, would you close us in prayer?
Two logistical things. One is many of you who have received these reports, some of the reports, pages 9 and 10, are missing. So if you have a report that page 9 and 10 is missing, please see us out in the lobby afterwards, or better yet, because we don't have time to take questions from the floor at this point in the assembly, we're going to be having a breakout luncheon right after this in room 204 in the main building here. We'll be upstairs in room 204. Come. The whole purpose of that luncheon is to listen and ask questions, and we'll do our best to respond to those things. But I have the joy of asking my good brother, our moderator-elect, Glenn Myers, to come up and close us as he prays that we might be able to reach the communities immediately around us for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Glenn, would you close us in prayer? Thanks.
Allow me to lead you in prayer. Father God, we thank you for the work of this task force. We thank you for Revelation 7, 9, and that vision. We thank you that you've placed it on the heart of our denomination to reach our neighbors, the ones you've called us to love. Lord, we ask that you empower us by your Spirit to be bold for the sake of the gospel, which is at the center of all of this, for the sake of Jesus who died for the entire world. We undertake these tasks not for the sake of diversity in of itself, but for the wholeness of your vision and the wholeness of your church. Lord, I ask your blessing on the continued work of this task force, and I ask that for each of our churches, that you give us a compassionate heart for our neighbors, that we might see people that we don't otherwise see, that we might reach them with the gospel, because that is what you are about. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for this work. We thank you for your promise to be with us in it. We have to ask all these things and give you the honor and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.